Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon and welcome. My name is James Rondo, and I have the great privilege and honor of serving as the president and Eloise W. Martin, director of our great museum. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to the museum today for our first program of 2024, an extraordinary performance of Camille Claudel, Into the Fire. At the outset, it is my great privilege to welcome composer Jake Heggie and the world-renowned mezzo-soprano Joyce DiDonato. More with them in a minute. Today's event is a truly spectacular way to celebrate our Camille Claudel exhibition as we re-engage contemporary audiences with her important and still woefully under-recognized achievements. Our exhibition on view through February 19th in the first floor of our modern wing and expertly curated by our Emerson Boyer, the museum's Searle Curator of Painting and Sculpture of Europe. The exhibition marks the 130th anniversary of the first public presentation of Claudel's sculpture in America, which happened here in Chicago in 1893 at the World's Columbian Exposition. And we gather today here on the actual site of the programming hall of the Columbian Exposition. It wasn't configured exactly like this. It was an open courtyard. But this was the northernmost outpost, of the Columbian Exposition. And so as we program here together today, we bring that spirit forward of the history of the World's Exposition that brought us Claudel. So I'm also super grateful to acknowledge how integral many of you are to our museum family. It's emphatic thanks that I bring to the space today for your unwavering support of our museum and particularly our work on Camille Claudel. Today, we extend our great thanks to an anonymous donor for providing lead funding for the exhibition. For providing major support, we are deeply grateful to Mario Walter and Carla Goldschmidt Foundation, another anonymous donor, Amy and Paul Carbone, Marion A. Cameron Gray, Nancy and Sanfred Koltun, Barbara and James McGinnitie, Monika A. McLennan, Robert and Sandy Stuart, and Diane M. Tkach and James F. Freundt. Critical support for today's event is also provided by the Green Research Fund, which enables special projects for the Department of Painting and Sculpture of Europe. Mary Winton Green, our trustee for whom the fund is named, is here today. Welcome, Mary, and welcome to your daughter. Your daughter, Sarah Cohen. Mary, Sarah, welcome. We thank you both and the family for your extraordinary support of our museum. Incredibly generous and incredibly important to the work that Gloria and her team lead. Thank you. Today's program is also supported by the Carol Given Winston Fund. Carol was a cherished member of our museum family for 38 years, introducing students and visitors of all ages to our collections and exhibitions. The fund that bears her name was established to inspire those who share Carol's love of art and learning. I'm happy to welcome two of Carol's children here today, Gail Trabeau and Bert Winston. Welcome and thank you. But today we are gathered because artists like Claudel illuminate other great artists. Composer Jake Heggie wrote Camille Claudel, Into the Fire, an operatic song cycle first performed in 2012 by the great Joyce DiDonato. It has become a passion piece for both Joyce and the Brentano String Quartet, who performed it together at Carnegie Hall in 2015. Each song, as you'll hear, draws inspiration from a specific Claudel artwork, all of which are featured in our exhibition. To Jake, to Joyce, and the Brentanos, it is my honor to welcome you to the Art Institute of Chicago and to thank you profoundly for sharing this important composition with our audiences. you know, in terms of mission, dynamically reconsidering the art of our past to inspire ideas or even new art forms in the present. This is core to what we seek to achieve, and it really is amongst the best interpretive gifts that we can offer to our audiences. So for that, we also thank you. So now please join me in welcoming, resoundingly welcoming, curator Emerson Boyer and composer Jake Heggie to the stage. Gentlemen.
Thank you, everybody, for coming out today on this snowy day. We're super excited. We have been planning this since May of last year, and to see it finally come to fruition is extremely exciting. I'm so thrilled to have you with us today, Jake. I know it's been an extremely busy 12 months and very successful 12 months, so for you to make time to be here is extraordinary.
Oh, this is a real dream come true, everyone. This is feels like a full circle moment. You know those moments in your life where suddenly things all come together and you're just like, wow, it's like it was always meant to be. And before we go any further, I do want to introduce the man who wrote the incredible lyrics and texts and poetry for this cycle, who is not only one of the great librettists of the world, a great lyricist, a great songwriter. You know his American anthem that Nora Jones sang for Ken Burns' series. And he flew in from New York to be for this full circle moment to be with us today. And it's Mr. Gene Scheer. He's right there. But it does feel like this amazing moment. The cycle, we wrote it 12 years ago. I first was hit with Camille Claudel. You have to tell me when you first were hit with Camille Claudel. But I was first hit in the late 80s, 1988 or 89, when the movie Camille Claudel came out with Isabelle Adjani and Gérard Depardieu. And I just knew from that moment, I had to do something with it at some point. I just didn't know what it was going to be.
So what was it about the film or about Camille and her story that really drew you to her?
Well, what draws us all to her, not only is the sculpture extraordinary, beyond extraordinary, brilliant, singular, moving, thrilling, so full of ideas and life and motion, but her story is so compelling. The excitement of her early years and the tragedy of her later years. I mean, it is an operatic existence, the whole thing. And especially the time period when she lived, when women were not treated very well as artists, and she defied all of the categories that people wanted to box her in.
Well, and that movie was singularly important in the rediscovery of Camille Claudel. It was based on a novel or sort of fictionalized biography. The movie gained great acclaim in America, and you know it was nominated for Academy Awards, and so it was a real buzz at that moment. And that's when scholars, you know, it's funny, you know, you suddenly have scholars looking at someone because of a movie in a way. So that was a singular moment. So what did you think you were going to do once you thought, okay, Camille Claudel?
I don't know. It was at a very difficult time in my life in the late 80s where I had been developing a career as a pianist and composer and then developed a focal dystonia in my right hand that caused me to stop playing the piano for quite a while, for years. And but I had to find a way to make a living. So I became the PR guy at the UCLA Center for the Arts, and then I moved to San Francisco and got a job at the San Francisco Opera as the PR marketing writer and started to get to know great singers. And this was in 1994, so just a few years later, and I started writing songs for them. And lo and behold, along a few years later, I suddenly am asked to write an opera, which it literally came from out of the blue, people. It was just the most amazing thing. All of a sudden, Frederica von Stade and Renee Fleming and Sylvie McNair and Bryn Terfel were singing my songs all over the world, and the general director at the San Francisco Opera said, hey, have you ever thought about writing an opera? It's a normal question to ask the PR guy. Anyway. And I said, actually, no, I have never thought about that. But he sent me to New York to meet Terrence McNally, and we wrote our first opera, which was Dead Man Walking. And thank you. And it was, so all of a sudden the door opened and I now had a career writing music and writing music dramas. And Camille was always in my head. I didn't know what it was going to be. And at first I thought it might be an opera. And I literally, Anthony Freud, who's here, who with the Lyric Opera Chicago, was at Houston Grand Opera. And we actually talked about possibly it being an opera with Joyce as Camille Claudel and Bryn Terfel as Rodin. I know everyone. I mean, I had the same reaction. It's like, I was like, wow, that would be so amazing. But then the more I thought about it, and I knew how many years it takes to write an opera, and the story is ultimately so dark because of her last years, I couldn't picture giving that much time to it. And like you said, it would be very hard on an audience as well.
Oh, yeah, I'm not sure I'd make it to the end.
Yeah. Even with gorgeous singing. And so all of a sudden in like 2010 or late 10 or 11, we had just finished, Gene and I had just finished writing Moby Dick. And the wonderful Ruth Felt, who runs San Francisco Performances, back then she created that series. She was looking to celebrate an anniversary of a string quartet, and they want and to commission me. And I thought, yeah, I want to do it. But I, and she said, and you could also include a singer. And I said, I'm all in. I said, could that singer be Joyce DiDonato? And she said, yes. And I said, I'm really all in. Then it was figuring out what's it going to be. And all of a sudden, I think I was in Central City for a production of something or other. And all of a sudden, the whole thing started to come to me, and I called Gene and I called Joyce, and they were both all in, and that's the gestation. It was a long time coming, but it came at exactly the right time and exactly the right format, because yeah, we can celebrate her through her work and her sculpture. And the way Gene conceived of this is so extraordinary.
The lyrics are extraordinary, and I encourage people to take the closest of looks at them, because as you said, it's poetry. And what's so incredible about them as well is the fact that Gene is often quoting Claudel's own words. And so there is a sense of real authenticity and of being respectful enough to give this woman the chance to speak herself, which she was often denied in her lifetime. And so that is one of the amazing parts of this story. And, you know, the other amazing thing that you just touched on and what really drew me to the piece, as I was co-organizing this exhibition with my wonderful co-curator, Annalise Demar from the Getty, who is here today, we wanted to stress an understanding of the artist through her artworks as much as possible, and to put the artworks first and to allow them to be the core from which you move out and understand also her life and what was going on contextually at the time. And you have structured the song cycles around individual works.
Gene and I had done a set of songs for a wonderful mezzo-soprano called Joyce Castle, named Joyce Castle, based on different sculptures. It's called Statuesque, and it was different sculptures and the interior life of these sculptures based on Jean's research and beautiful work. With Camille, because we don't know everything about her life.
Yeah.
There's a lot we don't know. We know the major events, we know the tragedy, we also know the excitement and the joy of those early years, but we also know that just before she was institutionalized, she destroyed an enormous number of her sculptures.
Yes.
For various reasons, we can never know always, but she was definitely afraid that they were going to be stolen and claimed by someone else. She was worried about Rodin's influence over her and the way he had been controlling her career. And so we knew we wanted to focus on the sculptures to tell some of her story, some of her interior life, because you do get so much information about her.
Yes.
You look at this, I mean, first of all, have you been to this exhibit yet? It's extraordinary. I was in tears. I saw it today, and I was just in tears because it's so beautifully done, and it gives you the way it's laid out, too, this sense of motion and sweep through her life and places where it stalls and where it moves, her vision of Rodin versus his vision of her. Very interesting. Mm. But it's congratulations, because it is magnificent. But we really wanted to focus on telling the story that we could discover through the stories she chose to tell in her sculptures.
Yes.
And so the whole thing is set up to open, in our imaginations, the day she knows she's going to be taken to the asylum. She knows she's been betrayed. She knows she's been turned on by her family. She knows she may never sculpt again. She's destroyed a good deal of her work. And so the whole opening of the piece is it's called Awakening, and it's just the quartet. And it's the sun and the light coming in. Who knows if she got any sleep that night? But I get emotional talking about it. But it's imagining the day when you know it's over and this other chapter is about to begin. And finding the music for that, and then what would be the order of sculptures. We went through a lot of different sculptures, and Jean wrote several texts or several different treatments until the right thing emerged.
Yes.
But it was really, the first thing was this meditation on that bust of Rodin.
So maybe we can perhaps walk through the sequence of movements. Would be amazing, I think.
Yeah. Her first words are from a letter last night, and some of you, I hope, have the texts. I don't know if there's extra copies in case people don't have them that can be brought down. I mean, a lot of people don't have them. Is there anyone back there who has them? Anyway, I'll do my best, sorry. The text is, last night I went to sleep completely naked, pretending you were holding me, which is based on a letter from her.
Yes.
And we just imagine her waking up and looking at this bust of Rodin and meditating on it, what her relationship to him was and how it changed her life. And some of the words are, was I dreaming that you loved me, though you left me far behind? Someone's there, hidden in the shadows. You don't want me to see, you don't want me to find. In the clay, I search with my fingers to uncover something true, Rodin. Was there ever a time you wanted me to find you? That's beautiful words. You know, I mean, when it's the right lyric and the music just comes. And that's when this motif that you'll hear through the whole piece emerged on the name Rodin. Rodin, Rodin, which you'll hear throughout. And the awakening has this very beautiful music, which I attribute to the core of her, the beauty of her soul. And that comes at the beginning and finds its way, weaves its way through. I love motifs. I'm a theater guy. So, but that's the first one, is her really meditating on that. And I mean, just when you see that sculpture up front, up close, it is amazing, the strength and the power of it.
Oh, yeah. And also, to imagine, I mean, when you make a portrait, you have the sitter in front of you. So she would have been there with her clay, Rodin across from her. Can you even just imagine the crackling energy between these two gargantuan personalities as she made his likeness?
Right.
It's an extraordinary, we don't often imagine the encounters that bring about portraiture.
Right. And then thinking of the full circle, which is what Jean was thinking of that youthful energy of when they were together, like you said, that crackling energy, but then the full circle again to where it's one of the last things that she'll see, you know, of her work. And then the next is La Valse, which... you talk a little bit about that sculpture, because it was scandalous.
It was a scandalous sculpture. And when she first produced it, it was two entirely nude figures dancing together. And at that time, if you wanted a commission for a work in bronze or marble, because it was expensive, you tried to get the French government to commission you. And an art inspector from the French Ministry of Culture came out, to her studio to look at the work, and he wrote this scathing report about how scandalized he was by the fact that the figures were both nude, their crotches were pressed together. I'm sure
it was sculpted by a woman.
Yeah, I mean, if Rodin had done it, I'm sure, you know, it would have been fine. But, you know, and so she said, oh, well, fine. And so she added drapery, this extraordinary cascading drapery. And then the government art inspector came back and he said, all right, Mademoiselle Claudel has sufficiently veiled the female body. I recommend it for a commission. But the Minister of Culture was still scandalized and thought she transgressed the limits of propriety. So it was never commissioned by the state. But it's this hymn to ecstatic movement. Mm-hmm.
And sex, okay, yes. Let's call it what it is. It's very, very sexual and sensual. And, you know, you can imagine, again, Camille's incredible energy, and especially when she was working with Rodin and discovering things and moving forward. And so to put that, juxtapose that with the sculpture of him. And the song actually starts with the singer whispering, Rodin. Like, is he there? Again, is he haunting me? Is he here? Is he doing all of this? And suddenly this waltz starts, and it's a very fast waltz, not really one that you could dance to, but you could move to it. So, and that uncovers, and it's, again, Jean's words are so beautiful. Take me one step closer, one step back, one step spins, one step hovers. Take me to the place for unrepentant lovers. Console my eyes with beauty. Allow me to forget that every dance of love is mingled with regret. It's beautiful words.
Well, and I love that, you know, you said the music is moving faster than you would be able to. You know, there's a sense of being on the verge of losing balance, being out of control with this work. Camille is sculpting on the edge here. I mean, sculpture is about stillness and gravity and being weighted to the ground. These figures are about to spin off into the sky. And so I think
that
captures it.
We said in the exhibit, it has to be bolted down or it would fall
over. Yes, the first version of this work, it weighs about 400 pounds. And at the angle the figures are at, if we didn't screw it down under the platform, it would threaten to tip over.
Wow. That's amazing.
So shall we?
Then the next one is Shakuntala, and it's based on a Hindu myth about a king and the woman he's in love with and is going to have a child with. And one day the woman, Shakuntala, she offends a sage, and the sage curses her to forget whoever she was thinking of in that moment. No, that not she will forget, that person will forget her. And so she was forgotten, she was banished, until one day the king remembers because of a ring inside of a fish that he was eating, and he suddenly realizes he has to find her, and this is the moment of their reunion. And it's so full of passion and love and struggle, and Jean found just the right things to say. It's a very fast piece, and it really explores the coloratura part of Joyce's voice, which we really wanted to explore. The last part of it is, after he had learned the truth, after all his tears, begging my forgiveness, after wasting many years, wishing to reclaim me, kneeling at my feet, he reaches to embrace me. Will the circle again be complete? I lean and let him hold me, his lips familiar yet estranged. I forgive him utterly, but in doing so, have I changed? I hear your whispers, your cries. I want to take you back, my love, but who I was has died. I mean, he really captured it. Thank you so much, Jean. And again, these collaborations with Jean have been so meaningful. But to find the struggle, and today, when you were showing me the exhibit, I saw for the first time the other side of the sculpture, which I had never seen, and the beautiful hands, and that they're not quite touching yet. The embrace is incomplete. And the beautiful hands, the motion of it is so powerful, and how conflicted you feel her.
Yeah, I mean, you pointed out to me something that I hadn't really thought about, which was there is a certain ambiguity to this reunion, perhaps. And I thought that that was really beautiful.
Right. Not from his part. Yes. From his part, yes. He's desperate to hold her again. But from hers, the hand is here, but is it pulling back or is it leaning in? You know, yeah. And so in the life of Camille, you know, you can imagine this moment playing in her head in reference to Rodin many
Absolutely.
Times, you know. And then La Petite Châtelaine, you have four different versions of this in the exhibit. They're so beautiful. And we don't know all the details, but we think that she started, Rodin, the story is, had basically betrayed her. She had been promised that he was going to leave Rose Bure, his mistress, and that he signed a contract with her. He was gonna leave Rose, they were gonna go off into the country, and she was gonna be his only student, and they were gonna work together, and he signed all of this, and he did none of it. And in fact, she became pregnant and aborted that child. And again, the details are vague. But shortly after that would have happened, she went to recover and wrote a lot in her journal and sculpted this, La Petite Châtelaine. And Jean again wrote these beautiful words, "Hello, my little one, La Petite Châtelaine. Do you know who I am?" And then he quotes a letter or a journal entry where they say I leave at night by the window of my tower, hanging from a red umbrella with which I set fire to the forest. Hello, my little one. Do you know who I am, or the land where you come from, where the earth is stained? I did as he said and returned you to clay. How could I bleed such a blessing away? Now I'm forever alone with my children of stone. La Petite Châtelaine, can you hear my voice? The voice of your mother. It's very, very powerful.
It's a beautiful, beautiful sculpture, and it's important to remind people that, you know, Rodin didn't carve a marble in his life. He always contracted out to others to produce his marbles. Camille Claudel carved in marble herself. She was very proud of it. In fact, we suspect that she must have carved some of Rodin's marbles during her time in the studio. This is one of the first independent works of her own that she carved in marble. And she was exceptional as a marble carver and devoted so much of her physical and emotional life to the carving of marble, to pushing herself to the point of exhaustion sometimes. But, you know, having everything be by her hand was quite important.
Then the next one is, you call it the chatterboxes. We call it the gossips, les causeuses. It's the same kind of thing.
It's the same thing.
And it is the most remarkable piece. Can you tell us a little bit about the piece?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this was unprecedented when she exhibited it at the Salon in Paris. It is carved from a very difficult and brittle stone, marble onyx. She had to repair it multiple times as she was making it. And the work is based on a scene that she had witnessed in real life, which was a group of women talking together animatedly in an omnibus or in a train carriage. And then she stripped it back to nude figures in a sort of ambiguous space to make it more universal, I think. And this was a moment when she had left Rodin. She had entered her own studio in the 13th arrondissement in Paris, and she was determined, like stung by everything that was said about her by the critics, about the fact that she was, you know, too close to Rodin, that her work was merely an imitation of Rodin. You know, the fact that she felt she had to do anything about that is unbelievable. And so she determined to forge a new style, and this was it. These exquisite, miniaturized mise-en-scenes, which we'd seen nothing like it before.
And also a time in her life when the gossip around her, because she wasn't respected or totally on her own. As, I mean, except for people who really the few people who really recognize her.
A small group,
right.
Yes.
But otherwise, she was referred to as, you know, Rodin's student, Rodin's mistress, Rodin's this or that or the other, always in context to Rodin. So the talk and the gossip around her would have been deeply upsetting. Plus, she had been through this, you know, abortion, we think, and her family was rebelling against her because it was so scandalous, and they were a traditional sort of Catholic family. And her father had died at this point, I think, yes?
Not yet.
Not yet.
No.
But the man that, who really believed in her, her father, but her brother, Paul Claudel, was a poet and a diplomat. Anyway, was scandalized by the affair with Rodin. And here she is on her own. And as a theater person, I just imagined her so confused by all the voices and what they want, what they're talking about. And when you know people are talking about you and, you know, talking smack about you behind your back, it's not a good feeling. And so to be a creative artist, and so the way I imagine it musically is all this chattering coming from the quartet, like the four figures. This was actually seminal in deciding it was going to be a quartet, was the four figures all chattering away, and Camille has this long vocal line wondering what's going on around her. And if it were ever staged, I always imagined it that this there was like this beam of light that she's walking through, because it's such an unknowable journey that she went through while all this sound is going all around her. And wondering what's going wrong with her. So it starts with, what is in my hands? What is in my head? So many ideas, my mind aches. So many ideas, the earth quakes. And then Jean quotes her again, ideas that she was actually going on, you know, regular scenes.
Yes.
Even mentioning this one. So people at a table listen to a prayer. Three men on a high cart laugh and go to mass. A woman crouches on a bench and cries all alone. What does she know? Anyway, it's very powerful. And then this is the moment when we sort of imagined this is, she's going to be taken away at this. This is the end of that part of the scene in the drama. Because then the next piece, which is her monstrous masterpiece that normally resides in the Orsay, L'Âge Mûr, which can either be the Iron Age or the Age of Maturity. And this is purely instrumental. And that was really because this is when her voice was taken away, when she was taken to the asylum. And after this piece, you can tell them a little bit about this amazing
sculpture.
This is
Camille be at her most autobiographical. I mean, this work is an extraordinary bearing of one's soul publicly. And to think of a woman doing this in the late 19th century is unheard of and extraordinary. It depicts supposedly the path of life or the path of human destiny as a tragedy. So you have in the center a middle-aged man being led away into the distance and the future and death, and away from the imploring arms of a kneeling youth. Now, what nobody mentioned at the time, but which everybody knew, was that this actually pictured Rodin in the middle, being dragged away by his long-term mistress, Rose Barret, from the kneeling Camille Claudel. And the French government initially liked this sculpture and had drawn up a contract to have her produce it in bronze. But suddenly and inexplicably, the contract was cancelled. And what we think happened was that Rodin went to the Ministry of Culture and said, you cannot commission this work from Camille because it exposes my public life. So it really is one concrete example of a moment when, you know, he behaved in a, you know, in a particularly bad way, I think.
But so this is entirely instrumental with the quartet, and you'll hear the theme that was we initially heard of Rodin, and it's also last night, all this meditation on the name Rodin and it building to this crescendo, and it represents the years of her being taken to the asylum and being in the asylum, and how the world is changing around her, and she doesn't know it. While she was in the asylum, the staff there was saying, no, she needs to be with people. They wrote to the family, she needs to be with people, she needs to see
you. And closer to the family.
Right, and closer, and to work, and none of that was allowed.
No.
And the family, I mean, her brother visited her like 7 times. Her mother never came to see her.
No.
And she was in the institution for 30 years.
And she had very restricted, she was very restricted in terms of who the family would allow to visit her. And it was generally close family until right at the end. And also she was denied the ability to write correspondence and to receive correspondence.
Right. So she wasn't mad in the asylum when she got there. She would have been, you know, very shortly after. But even then they said, no, she's fine. She needs to be near family.
Yeah. Yep.
But the family had been so scandalized by her. And so this is the last image we have of her with her. That's Camille on the left and her friend Jesse Lipscomb on the right. And Jesse and she had been in Rodin's atelier together as young women, sculpting and creating. And in 1929, Jesse and her husband were making a journey and decided to find Camille and to go see her. And Jean just wrote the most beautiful text. And you can imagine what it must have been like for Camille, who had had such motion and energy and vitality in her life, to have nothing but stillness for so long. And Jean's text is, thank you for coming. I thought everyone had forgotten. Thank you for remembering me. And she reflects on Jesse's family and remembering the time in Paris. Oh, Jesse, every dream I ever had was of movement, touching, breathing, reaching, hovering, something always about to change. A photograph? Just me and you. Yes, I understand. I must be very still. Thank you for remembering me. And I have to... That's why this feels like such a full circle moment, to be able to do this piece here with all of you who have this new awareness of her work, who she was, and this beautifully curated exhibit. I have to tell a little bit about how this all happened, because amazing Gloria Groom, who is sitting there, we were at a party over at Sarah and Dan's house with Mary in May, and we were talking, and I was, you know, Dead Man Walking was going to happen in the fall, and I mentioned Joyce DiDonato was going to be singing it, and you went, oh, Joyce DiDonato. You know, she sings this cycle about Camille Claudel, and we're having this big exhibition, and I wish there were a way we could get her here, and I was like, well, I might know a thing or two about that cycle. and it was from that conversation in that moment, and she made all of this happen. And this was the moment when it worked perfectly in Joyce's schedule, and then the Brentano Quartet was available. They've recorded the cycle and performed it extensively. And you're here, and the exhibit is here. It's just a really remarkable moment.
It's been a dream come true for us, and to see how enthusiastically you and Joyce and the Brentano Quartet have embraced this, to have Jean here as well. I mean, this is truly a dream come true. So thank you. I was so moved, I just started walking off and forgot I have something to do. I thought, oh, I'm done. It is my great pleasure now to introduce today's performers. Multi-Grammy Award winner in 2018, Olivier Award winner for outstanding achievement in opera, Kansas-born Joyce DiDonato entrances audiences across the globe and has been proclaimed perhaps the most potent female singer of her generation. With a voice, quote, nothing less than 24 karat gold, according to the Times, Joyce has towered to the top of the industry as a performer, a producer, and a fierce advocate for the arts. With a repertoire spanning over four centuries, a varied and highly acclaimed discography, and industry-leading projects, her artistry has defined what it is to be a singer in the 21st century. Since its inception in 1992, the Brentano String Quartet has appeared throughout the world to popular and critical acclaim. Within a few years of its formation, the quartet garnered the first Cleveland Quartet Award and the Naumburg Chamber Music Award, and was also honored in the UK with the Royal Philharmonic Award for Most Outstanding Debut. The quartet has performed in the world's most prestigious venues, including Carnegie Hall in New York, the Library of Congress in Washington, and the Sydney Opera House. Since 2014, the Brentano Quartet has served as artists in residence at the Yale School of Music. Please join your hands together to welcome the performers.
Thank you. Shakuntala. the bench and cry. Just me and you.